Essentially, it was an alarmist tactic used to discredit the agitation and propagate the myth that Punjab was full of Sikh separatists. I know it had this effect on me personally. My reaction on reading the newspapers was, "Who are these lunatics wanting Khalistan?" Fortunately, I was in a position to discover the truth of the matter. However, most people have to rely entirely on the media, and there seems little doubt that this scare propaganda was effective in generating anti-Sikh feelings in India. The Sikhs in general, and Bindranwale in particular, were held responsible for the lawlessness in the state. This conclusion was based on purely circumstantial evidence, namely, the erroneous assumption that an armed Sikh implied a terrorist or an extremist. Leaving aside Sikh principles for the moment, even the bare facts of the situation refute the government's allegations. For example, Swami, an MP from Bombay who visited the Golden Temple in late April 1984, noted some disturbing inconsistencies. As a three-day resident at the Golden Temple, I was not in a position to ascertain if criminals were hiding in the temple complex. I cannot recognize any of them. The government keeps saying that criminals are hiding in the temple area. Only once, about a year and a half ago, the government sent a list of 40 criminals to SGPC. On examination, the SGPC found that 18 of them just could not be in the Golden Temple. Some were in Pakistani jails for hijacking, some were in Canada and West Germany, and by the government's own admission in Parliament, two were dead. The remaining 22 could not be located inside the temple by the SGPC screening committee, since the particulars provided by the government were too vague. Later, in the Lok Sabha, the Home Minister, P.C. Sethi, admitted these facts. Since then, no further lists have been sent to the SGPC, and yet the government keeps declaring that criminals are hiding in the temple complex. I am also amazed to read newspaper reports of criminals walking in and out of the temple campus undetected. The Golden Temple complex and its exits are surrounded by the Central Reserve Police Force, the Border Security Force, and the Punjab Police. In addition, RAW, IB, and state CID agents, who in plain clothes swarm the precincts of the temple, yet proclaim offenders stroll in and out of the temple complex. How can this be? Indeed, how could it be that the Sikhs could allow their most sacred shrine to be used as a terrorist camp? The question is absurd. If there had been a shred of evidence that Bindranwale and his group were terrorists, they would have been immediately thrown out of the Golden Temple complex by the Sikhs. Sant Jarnail Singh Bindranwale was a religious preacher and the head of a highly respected missionary center, the Damdami Taksal. This Taksal was set up by Guru Gobind Singh, who appointed Baba Deep Singh to lead this center in 1708. However, this Taksal fell back into relative obscurity until it was headed by Sant Gurbachan Singh in the mid-1950s. Gurbachan Singh was a very learned scholar and returned the Damdama Taksal to the forefront of Sikhism. As Sant Gurbachan Singh lived at Binder, this Taksal became associated with this village. Jarnail Singh grew up at this Taksal and obtained his religious training from Sant Gurbachan Singh. In 1977, he was selected to lead this Taksal, and consequently he too was associated with the name of Binder and became known as Bindranwale. Sant Jarnail Singh vigorously pursued his duties as a missionary and went from village to village preaching about Sikhism. He was a powerful speaker and became successful in his endeavors. However, his success was resented by fundamentalist Hindu organizations in the Punjab, such as the Arya Samaj. He was harassed by these groups to the extent that his fellow missionaries were beaten up, their transport set alight, and even copies of the Sikh scriptures they carried were torn and burned. He became increasingly aware of the injustice of broken promises in Punjab and the widespread discrimination against the Sikhs, and started to speak out against this. In fact, it was Bindranwale who initiated the peaceful agitation in Punjab on July 20, 1982. Every day, 51 members of his group would go out on demonstrations and court arrest. Later, when the Akali Dal decided to take up the cause and launched its statewide campaign, Bindranwale terminated his demonstrations and backed the Akali Morcha for the implementation of the Anandpur Resolution. It is often said that Bindranwale was a creation of Mrs. Gandhi, which went wrong. She supported him when her opponents were in power, but he became a nuisance when she was returned to office. There may well have been a change of heart on her part, but as far as Bindranwale was concerned, his duty as a Sikh was to speak out against injustice. This he did, irrespective of who was in power. To counteract Bindranwale's growing popularity, The Indian government launched a vicious propaganda campaign against him. They branded him as an armed extremist and accused him of being responsible for terrorism in Punjab. In the media, he was portrayed as a fanatical figure wreaking havoc in Punjab from the sanctuary of the Golden Temple. He was even dubbed India's Khomeini. However, the only evidence for these allegations was circumstantial. The naive argument ran along the lines of, "Oh look, lots of people have been killed in Punjab, and there are people with guns in the Golden Temple." For a start, the figures of violence seem to have been exaggerated. Over the 2 years of the Morcha, virtually every murder in Punjab was attributed to the agitation. The fact that most murders in Punjab arise from family feuds over land ownership seems to have been forgotten. Indeed, the rest of India was hardly free from murder and violence over the same period. Nevertheless, there were some acts of terrorism with a blatantly sectarian flavor. But these acts could never be condoned by a Sikh, for they run totally against the grain of Sikhism. These acts were, rightly, condemned by Bindranwale and the other Sikh leaders. As the agitation progressed, however, an increasing note of cynicism crept into Bindranwale's condemnations. In Patiala, one Ashok Kumar was shot dead. No Sikh expressed the view that this was a good act. The killing was condemned by all the responsible Sikh leaders. But even before his cremation, a judicial inquiry was ordered into the circumstances of his death. On the other hand, the Akali Dal has repeatedly demanded judicial inquiries into the killing of 156, but Indira Gandhi has not ordered an inquiry into even a single case. This introduces another important point. Over the 2 years of the Morcha, an equal, if not greater, number of Sikhs were killed. 150 died while in police custody, 25 people were shot dead at just one peaceful demonstration, and scores of Sikhs were massacred in the neighboring state of Haryana. Of course, this does not excuse the murder of Hindus in Punjab, but it does illustrate the way in which the facts were distorted. Massive coverage was given to the activities of alleged Sikh terrorists, while little or no coverage was given to the atrocities committed against the Sikhs, nor to the peaceful nature of the agitation. As the campaign progressed, the government's reaction to the agitation on the ground was to engage in a further vicious persecution of those taking part in the protests. Suspected activists were arrested and tortured by the police, and often murdered in so-called encounters with terrorists. Furthermore, the families of these suspected activists were also harassed, frequently to the extent of being thrown in jail, being physically abused, and having their property burned and their livelihoods destroyed. As time went on, these atrocities grew, and Bindranwale was forced to add the proviso. "You can only have justice if there is the rule of law, someone to enforce it, and the right of appeal. Where will you go when no one cares for the judge or for the law, and they are all powerful? It is with your own hands you will then have to solve the problem." For the Sikhs who were immersed in the struggle, Sant Jarnal Singh Khalsa, Bindranwale, was the epitome of their faith, a man committed to the high ideals of being a saint soldier. "Even if it results in my body being cut to small pieces, I shall still fight against injustice. If I am to live, I wish to live with honor. If I am to die, I wish to die for the Panth. I do not fear physical death, but death of the conscience is a sure death." Those people who have spent some time with Bindranwale vouch for his character. For example, Dr. Joyce Pettigrew of Queen's University Belfast writes of Bindranwale. "I met Jarnail Singh Bindranwale and Amrik Singh, president of the All India Sikh Students Federation, in mid-December 1983. They were not the fanatical figures full of hatred that the press portrayed. Bindranwale was quiet, with a sense of humor. He listened intently to the questions, answering directly if he could. On one occasion when he could not, he said quite openly that he had studied only to the fifth grade. He was unpretentious, apologizing twice if anything he had said offended me. Amrik Singh was very kind and possibly the more saintly of the two, but with less charismatic appeal. But sadly, it is as a fanatical extremist that Bindranwale was portrayed by the press and government officials. Even now it is disheartening to read newspaper reports referring to him as the high priest of violence." Mrs. Gandhi successfully manipulated the situation by implicating it was a regional communal dispute threatening her power. To this end, it is more than probable that her supporters were prepared to sacrifice innocent Hindu lives. Having made Bindranwale a scapegoat, the scene was now set for the attack on the Golden Temple. For now, the army action would not only wipe out the threat to her from the Punjab, but it would also make her popular with the majority Hindu electorate. Her attempt to abuse the democratic system in this way has sown the seeds of the current fanaticism of India under a Hindu doctrine as seen by rule of the BJP, Shiv Sena, and other extreme right Hindu parties. Finally, we come to Operation Bluestar, the army action in